The Irish in America broke the ground for a lot of succeeding generations of nationalities, and they made it a little easier for them to come in and assimilate. We were the first wave over. They were just thrown over here, and they were really on their own.
There's a great statement by one of the first of the Irish Catholics in this country, Charles Carroll, who was a signer of the Declaration of Independence. He was talking about the wrongs the Irish suffered. He said, "We must remember and forgive." And I think that's true of the modern Irish. We should remember it because it's so important, but we should forgive ourselves and forgive others for some of the mistakes that were made and the misdeeds that were done.
The Irish are old hands at telling stories. They like talk. They're word hungry. Their oldest stories in Gaelic can take days in the telling.
Goes back 2,000 years. Some of the words that I've said, relating as far back as that. From father to son, and from father to son, and his other son back again, and the generations one after the other. That's how it came down. The storytelling.
In every townland, there was some great storyteller. And he didn't tell the truth. In most cases, he never told the truth. But he would look forward to coming into the house that night, because he always had these yarns and stories. Because from the month of October, they sat at night in semi-darkness. And there was no other way of amusing themselves, only to tell stories. It was fun. Of course it was fun. That was all the fun you knew.
In the 1880s, over the Lower East Side of Manhattan, over the tenements that housed the Irish of New York, the signature work of the age was rising, the Brooklyn Bridge. It was Irish labor that built it, Irishmen who died in the East River mud. It was based on the conviction that all the immigrants, in fact, all working people, would rise together, and with government's help. In 4 terms as governor, Al Smith would pour 1 billion yards of concrete, erect 1 million tons of steel. But he would also change the focus of government with rent controls, subsidized housing and hospital care, limits on the price of power, heat, telephones. There would be a 10-fold pay hike for teachers and equal pay for women teachers. No one ever ruled Albany as he did. Still, from time to time, Smith would jump a train and go back to the old neighborhood, to walk across the Great Bridge and see his mother in Brooklyn Heights, or to join the boys from the Harrigan Club, singing songs from the Dan Mulligan plays, while a steamship carried them out to Jersey for the annual clam bake. And Smith would take in the new place, too. By the 1920s, when Al Smith had taken over the governor's chair, George M. Cohan had taken over Broadway. 10 productions in a single year.
I'm a Yankee Doodle Dandy, a Yankee Doodle Do-or-Die.
It's one of the big transitions in popular entertainment. An Irish American, a son of a group that was deemed un-American, unpatriotic in the middle of the 19th century, is suddenly defining for all Americans what it means to be an American.
His girl is a Yankee Doodle Joy. He is a Yankee Doodle Boy, born on the 4th of July. Now, how American can you get?
The New York dandy was high style, high hat, snap brim, gray spats. And the best dressed of all was Bo James, a Tin Pan Alley songwriter turned politician, and did pretty well. He was the gaudiest ornament of the Irish Golden Age. His honor, James J. Walker.
He's a fun mayor. He epitomized the ne'er-do-well of New York City. He was a household name. You'd see him in the newsreels. He had like 150 suits. Each suit had two pairs of pants and so forth, and he was a legend. Al Smith was Mr. New York State, and Jimmy Walker was Mr. New York City.
Al represented, you might say, the moral side of the Irish, the attempt to clean up Tammany, and Walker represented the wild Irish. The wide open city, the Tammany bosses that said, you know, let the good times roll.
New York was rolling in money and ambition, so much of it Irish. Joe Kennedy brought his bootleg and Hollywood millions to Wall Street, where he made millions more. F. Scott Fitzgerald held court at the Plaza. At Madison Square Garden, the champ, Jack Dempsey, ruled. And when the money rained, all the Irish went wet. Contractors couldn't lay brick fast enough, pave or wire, or lay pipe enough. In time for the Irish city inspector, the Irish photographer from the newspaper. Irish streetcar conductors were riding winners in the market. Some of their brokers were Irish too. Even Al Smith got swept along. When he'd come to town now, he wouldn't go home to Oliver Street. He'd take a couple of suites at the Biltmore. He had new friends, financiers. Reformers whispered that Smith had gone swanky, but the Irish loved him. And Walker, the bad boy, they loved him more.
He was described as part Beau Brummel, part gutter snipe. And Robert Moses describes Jimmy Walker coming into his office, and there's this pile of mail on his desk, and he says, any checks in there? And the secretary says no, and he sweeps all the letters off the desk onto the floor.
He always had a smile on his face. He was always dancing. He always had a glass of champagne in his hand. He defied all of the canons of respectability and morality.
Now, Mayor Walker wrote another song. All right. And then he gave the music to the police.
New York was America's champagne town, the bubblier for the fact that champagne was illegal. In Jimmy Walker's New York, the rules didn't apply. Anything was for sale. That's what turned Al Smith against him. For Smith, there was more than morality at stake. After Mr. Murphy's death in 1924, Al Smith was himself the boss of New York Democrats. He was the most admired governor in any state, and he meant to build a record that would resound across the country.
Who has the will to win, who not only deserves success, but commands it. Victory is his habit. The happy warrior, Alfred E. Smith.
his last years, Mr. Murphy had pushed Tammany power past the borders of New York. In alliance with other big state bosses, making deals with the right-wing Democrats of the South, Murphy laid the foundation for the third great Irish institution in the New World. First, the church in America, then the labor movement, now the new Democratic Party. Southerners, workers, and immigrants. Together, they would dominate U.S. politics through most of the century.
When Nell Smith was nominated, a wave of enormous pride swept through the Irish-American community.
It was almost like a euphoria in Lower Manhattan. They couldn't believe it, that he would have the nerve to do such a thing. It was one thing to acquire a certain amount of political power in your own Irish neighborhood in the Lower East Side. When Al Smith went to Albany, it was like, my God, we're almost at the top of the mountain. Now we were going to show the rest of the nation what one of our guys could do.
In the summer of 1938, Joseph P. Kennedy, the American ambassador to Great Britain, came home to New England. He had lunched the day before with President Roosevelt and shared a dish of strawberries with Eleanor. Reporters were asking about his own presidential ambitions. Kennedy, at 50, son of an Irish saloon keeper from East Boston, one of the nation's richest and most powerful men, had a lot to be happy about. But not enough.
Wherever Joe had gone, power was all that mattered. And the artifice that surrounded it, the wealth that underpinned it, couldn't hide that reality.
Mr. Gowdy, have you anything to say for it?
Nothing to say until I've seen the president.
All right, let's get going, boys. I'm gonna go home.
He chased money and was not always so ethical in the acquiring. He chased success and made political mischief. It is very moving to see people who aggress against the world and who want so much and who commit so much of their energies and their gifts and their time to getting it.
Both Kennedy and O'Neill were the grandsons of famine immigrants and men of monumental will. By the reach of their imagination, they stirred up powerful and conflicting impulses among the Irish in America. The ambassador would draw them forward to their dreams of wealth and power. The playwright would issue a warning. Beware, Irish dreamers. Your dreams might come true.
We walked, took the streetcar every place we went. The first dance you ever went to was, you know, down at St. Augustine School Hall, where the nuns made sure you kept, you know, the Holy Ghost between you and the girl you were trying to dance with. None of us knew how to dance.
I remember my mother saying, try not to be too much like everybody here. She'd say, you know, you can't just associate with these people from Ireland. And I hate to say it now, but she said they were thick mix. You know, she was trying to struggle up.
If a man didn't go to church, he was not recognized as a good, upstanding citizen in the community. The whole thing revolved around the church. That was an extension of the family living room, the family hearth.
People were proud of how close the community was. They had that sense of, hey, we're a little bit different here. You know, we're really tight, and it was a very small area to be in, and you didn't have to do a lot of thinking about what you were going to do. You know, there was very little for you to do.
If there was nothing holding the Irish back from the White House, there was nothing holding the Irish back from anything in American life. I think one of the real things that changed with Kennedy's election is the sense that the enemy was gone. What keeps an immigrant group together is not so much self-love, but fear of its enemies. And when the enemies go away, the need for cohesion, the need for holding together kind of goes away.
Thank you. Of course, there would be more enemies, old and new. Londoners would feel the impact of bombs paid for by Irish America. Blacks would feel Irish anger when they moved into Irish neighborhoods. But there would be no turning back from the Kennedy years. The gates had been opened and would remain open. The Irish could go where they would.
You lean on your history, and you lean on the history that's behind your history. You know, it's like you can't do it alone. And my granddaughter lives next door, and she'll know that she came from a town where her family has lived since 1834. So that's about seven generations. And if she does have an identity crisis when she's 21, which seems to be an obligatory rite of passage for Americans, she'll know that at her back is Irish culture to brace her.
We're here now. My mother was here. My father came from there. But where did I come from? Did I come from a farm in Roscommon? Was my grandfather a herder? Was he a sheep herder? I want to know that. It's very important to me. Before I die, I want to know where I came from.
In 1994, I went over to Ireland with my wife, and I said, I'd like to go to Galway, where my mother and father were from. And my parents, I had sort of always picked up, said they were like farmers. So I was telling my wife, yeah, my parents, they're farmers. So we drove up about 15 miles to rent a car, and they had two little signs, Carrow Row, Rosseville. I said, here it is. She looked around, and she said, what did they do, farm rocks? Because you didn't see one blade of grass. You didn't see one tree. I mean, all they were these rolling fields with nothing in there but big rocks and fences. And then all of a sudden, it sort of came back to me what my mother had told me about never having shoes until she was 13 and having to walk 3 or 4 miles to the next town to school and stuff like that in the winter. And that's when I realized how tough it had been. I never had given it much thought, you know, because I was always saying, hey, like, I'm an American.
But it was a great victory. This is what they came here for. They didn't come to stay together as Irish Americans. They came to find something else. And in the end, for better or for worse, whether it's a long day's journey into night or a long night's journey into day, they found what they were looking for.
So I had to leave for my car. child grown tall, her lover lies in the air, and for every rail we lay in the long, there's a thousand miles of the long journey.
Major funding for this program was provided by Jefferson Smurfit Corporation. Around the world, we're known for our paper, paperboard and packaging products, and paper recycling. We are proud of our Irish heritage through our association with Jefferson Smurfit Group.
Funding for this program was made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by annual financial support from viewers like you.
This is PBS.